you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
All right. Hello, everyone. My name is Francois. I'm a director of advanced projects at Epic Games.
And I'm Wyatt Savarese. I am the producer for advanced projects.
I want to take a second looking at the old footage of the old configurators there and say a big no thanks to Mark Roberts for showing that stuff. It's really old, so please don't remember us with that. But anyway, let's keep going. Huge progress, though. Back in those days, we didn't have clear coat paint material, so we couldn't do clear coat. We couldn't even have like a surface that had a smooth, shiny reflection. All things that were coming from the fact that Unreal Engine was a very game-focused engine. A lot of those optimizations went over the years and made what you guys are doing now possible, which is amazing to see. So looking at cars, we're going to take kind of a step away from cars for a little while and switch to spaceships. So the Apollo 11 Mission AR is what we're going to talk about a little bit here. It's our HoloLens 2 demo. We worked with Microsoft in the early days of the HoloLens 2 while the hardware was still in development. And we're going to talk to you a bit about the process.
So Microsoft came to us earlier this year, and they basically wanted to take the power of Unreal Engine and make a cutting-edge augmented reality, mixed reality experiencing using their unannounced HoloLens 2 at the time. When they first came to us, they didn't even have prototypes to send us. Epic was not supporting the HoloLens 1 at this time, so all of this had to be built while we were working on this project. And our main goal at Epic was to be able to make the best visuals seen in augmented reality. Most augmented reality experiences to date are basically just mobile renders, where you can see it's got very low resolution graphics and very low resolution textures. So working off of the information that HoloLens provided us, we started to think about what we were going to make. So basically, they let us know that the field of view has been increased by 46 pixel degree sight. It's built. The new finger depth sensor was one of the things we wanted to take advantage of, allowing people to do gestures and being able to track your hand. It has this amazing flip visor on it, so the ergonomics of this new device is amazing. It's also amazing for development. You can wear the device pretty much all day long when you're working in augmented reality. You can quickly put down the visor, go back in, check your stuff, flip it back up, and you're right back into work. It becomes part of like the working environment. And that also that it's now running 60 frames a second, and it's about 2K per screen. Well, what does this mean for Epic? Well, we had to start developing with our XR team up in our Seattle office all the things that we'd want to bring to the device so that we can actually start using it. One of the main things is that it's native support now with Unreal Engine 4.23 allowed us to have native support for the device, but it also allowed us to do pixel streaming, and that's something Francois is going to talk about in a little while. This also allowed us to put down spatial anchors, which allowed you to share space between multiple devices, being able to track certain objects in the same place, but sharing that anchor between both devices so that it would show up in the right spot. The real-time tracking of hands and skeletons. When you use the device now and you put your hands in front of it when you have the debug mode, you can actually see all the fingers, and it gives you fine manipulation of objects, being able to pick up and move things, being able to push buttons, no longer having to use like simple taps. And the gaze feature for using tracking, recognizing of voice commands, which was also in the original one, and pretty soon we're going to have object recognition. Basically, what this allows you to do is that the headset is constantly scanning your environment, and you'll be able to take the meshes that's being generated from these environments and use them in your actual development.
Cool. So, all right. So, giving some context, when we started this, as the engineering team was developing the integration of the HoloLens SDK into Unreal Engine, we had to start coming up with the content. So, you know, as Doug mentioned, it was the Apollo 50th anniversary of the moon landing this year. So, we thought that was a very interesting kind of a concept. It's still very heavy on visualization style in terms of the accuracy of the models. And also, they're a bit different. They have more reflections and they have more metals, and you're in this kind of interesting abstract environment. So we thought we'd give that a go. So yeah, we had the set of constraints. We wanted to make this demo kind of a portable tabletop so that we can bring it to different shows. So it's kind of more self-contained. We wanted to make sure that there was no kind of a learning process to use the demo. It was kind of an intuitive onboarding. So we kept the controls simple, even though we experimented with very fine hand gestures and gesture recognition. We found in the end that what worked best was kind of keeping it simple in terms of interaction and just touching and triggering events. It wanted the highest quality possible for an AR experience enabled by the pixel streaming. So you'll see some footage of that in a few minutes. The experience runs on a 2080 Ti. We don't do any ray tracing at all. It's just the machine that we have in our dev machines at Epic. And then the experience has to render two eyes, more or less about 2K each. and at 60 FPS. So those were kind of the targets. So we kind of, it was our first, or Epic's first, augmented reality demo. So, you know, this is the kind of interaction methods and what we had to discover what worked in AR, what didn't work in terms of interactions, in terms of assets and motion. We want the user to be able to go all around the content. So we storyboarded some kind of a lot more than what's on the screen here, but this is kind of what we end up coming with, the concept of being able to click and get details about some of the assets. And you see up there is kind of like our flow with each of the button presses that triggers different moments. So in terms of assets, the focus was to do kind of museum quality, high quality assets. It's not easy to get assets of these kind of Apollo 11 mission items. There's no, you know, pre-made Turbo Squid thing or CAD.
Well, there are pre-made Turbo Squid ones, but they are just basically, yes, looked at one photo. And the detail we wanted to show is we knew we were showing this off in augmented reality. People would be able to interact with it. So we really wanted to push forward with that.
Yeah, so we wanted the high quality stuff. So we had to do it ourselves. So we did a lot of work based on the restoration documents. This one's a 600-page document that shows everything down to the pieces of you know, the gold foil tape, all that stuff. So we kind of remodeled everything in a beautiful way. In the end, we ended up with a scene of about 7 million triangles, everything dynamically lit. We have, you know, clear coats and all kinds of crazy materials that are quite complex. And then we have FT convolution bloom, and, you know, we went all out with the post-processing. So this is what some of the look dev looks like. So this is as it appears in the HoloLens demo. This is what we call the CSM, which is the common module, and the astronauts were in the front there. And then we have the stage two of the Saturn V. So I'm not going to go through all the assets we did, but that's what it looked like.
We only have one part of the stage because, you know, it's the largest rocket that was ever built, and we just couldn't fit it on the screen.
Yes, and this is the lander, as it is seen in the demo, with all the detail on the foils and the pieces of tape, etc. Yeah. So yeah, we spent quite a bit of time adding the detail in there because we know users are going to be able to get really close to the assets with the HoloLens 2 and kind of inspect them. And that's where the interest of the demo is, I think. So how did we achieve those you know, very high-quality rendered 7-minute polys on an AR headset? Well, as I mentioned, we use something called the Microsoft Holographic App. So there's two ways to use the HoloLens 2. You can build an Unreal, an app, and deploy it to the device as you do for like a mobile phone or something like that. The problem is that turnaround is really slow, and then you're depending on the GPU power of the headset that's on your head. And that's much weaker than a normal PC. Now, the other approach is to actually use the holographic remoting app. So when you connect your, when you put on your headset, have it on the same Wi-Fi as the PC, and then the device is basically sending its position and its orientation as well as extra data like finger tracking and all that stuff back to the PC. The PC renders that in really high quality for both eyes, and then Pixel streams it back to your eyes and the headset. And that does it all with very low latency. So it allows us to achieve great graphics. We can use like a nice GPU. And we could do like kind of a little eye candy like this. So this is like a Ray March volumetric kind of effect. And I think that's kind of, it's pretty simple, but it's cool because if you use sprites, that doesn't really work in stereo, and you can't really go through things here. So pretty much all the effects you'll see in the demo are done using this technique.
And Francois might say that's simple, but in every single demo that's out there now, it's basically just sprites or the traditional way of getting your volumetrics on a card and putting it in there. This is actual real, you know, like you said, Ray March volumetric effects. So it gives you the effect that you wouldn't be able to do this the normal way, because if you do take your face and kind of put it in the flames when you have the headset on, you do see that the stuff is actually traveling around you. If it was just a card or if it was the traditional way, it would never look this good. So we talked about a lot of challenges that we had to do building, you know, just getting the headset working, having Unreal actually start coding and writing out all the stuff to actually get it to work. One of the big things that we realized while we were working on this project was the user in the headset is going to be able to see everything in there. But if we were to be doing a live stage demo with all of you lovely people in the audience, all you're going to see is two guys on stage with headsets. You're not going to actually see the graphics. So a big part of that is how you would do the mixed reality capture, which we realize is going to become a more and more standard thing when people start developing augmented reality apps or augmented reality programs. They're going to want to make either advertising out of it, or they're going to want to be able to show people at a stage show how they would do it. So there's tons of different ways that you can do it. We chose to go with more of a Vicon tracking solution and a composer, because if you think about the process, you have a camera that's filming your live action actors, and then they're wearing the headset. They can see the graphics inside the headset, but everybody else just sees them performing around it. The live action capture has to take the footage that Unreal Engine is generating and then composite it onto a layer, process that layer and spit it out, and that becomes your actual footage that you have. So as we were working through this, we came up with different solutions. We were using, and originally we were using a Windows mixed reality headset as our tracker. You can see it's the blue object in two of these photos. And then we started working on color calibration to make sure that the color between Unreal and our live footage was working together when we did our composite. And you can see in the photo on the right, that's Sean and Elijah, who is our model, wearing the HoloLens. That's our Sputnik. Basically, that's a tracking system that we built so that it can give coordinates of the camera back to Unreal Engine so that it could put it all together in the composite. And then this shoot actually led into our marketing video, which we're going to show you in a second.
Yeah, I just want to add up that the Vicon system was not our preferred system. It's the system that was a fallback as the kind of the location sharing between the HoloLens 2 and the other headsets was in early development at the time. So you shouldn't have to go through the Vicon system.
The spatial anchor sharing between Microsoft and HoloLens was not as developed when we were doing ours, but it should be coming down in their roadmap.
Yeah. All right, so we're going to show you kind of the marketing video up next and the footage that we shot. So one thing to note is that all the content inside CG is the same as seen on the headset. It's just seen through a different camera in this case.
But why, some say, the moon? Why choose this as our goal? And they may well ask, why climb the highest mountain? Why, 35 years ago, fly the Atlantic? We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Cool.